I think we're up. So hello, everybody, again. Great to have the discussion. Just have a short presentation I want to run through. I didn't have a special title, so I said ERP Next at Wiesbaden. So first, I want to thank Siebert Media and Martin for dragging me here and saying, look, we need to do a marketing. And I'm really thankful to Martin to set this event up. And I think it is a great spirit for, you know, driving the open source side of things also. And so thanks, Martin, to set this event up. Some reflections from, we had a conference last month. We have Hisham, we have Dominic here, and so it was a very intense conference. The conference before that, those who have been following ERP Next, was really a conference where we had fights in the community, because it was a conference where people were showing their customizations very proudly, but there was no contributions, and so maybe that I was quite frustrated last year, and then I thought nobody will come to this year's conference because nobody wants to come for the fight. But as it turned out, people showed up this year and they were looking forward for another fight. You know, that was maybe they came for the fight, and when there was no fight, everybody was disappointed. Oh, why is there no fight this year? But it's always a great great thing to really meet the people whom we have, you know, interacted. We've interacted with Gunnar for such a long time, and, you know, opportunity to meet him, and also Charles for the past couple of years. So I think these events are really good value, where you know the people who are behind the forum, and then, you know, you can't be so rude to them after that. So, and there is a lot of communication that happens at these events, you know, and I think this is a great way to build open source, is to do more events. So I just want to kind of summarize my thoughts, still kind of fresh from the conference. I think a lot of the discussion around ERP Next, the controversial part is, you know, what goes inside ERP Next, you know, what is architecture, what is the vision. Why monolith? We kind of briefly discussed that. I just want to cover my thoughts is that, you know, end of the day, good software is about, you know, don't repeat yourself. So if anything somebody has solved once, other people should not be forced to solve the same problem again. So that is kind of the vision behind saying monolith. One of the reasons and there are multiple dimensions why we started with the monolith. Initially, we did not have the engineering bandwidth to manage multiple repositories. So we thought it might just be a good idea to just have one repository. So we have one issue tracker, we have one list of pull requests. We are not looking for pull requests in 20 different repositories. It's just easier to have one list instead of, you know, 20 lists or 30 lists. So that was one of the reasons we said, let's build a monolith. Other reasons, as you discovered in other open source projects or so-called open core projects, is that when you create this app ecosystem, the motivation to contribute becomes much lesser than you control your own app, and then you decide that's where your core stuff. So the core always remains a very small core, and then the apps become the place where people start do their own contributions, because it's easier and there is nobody to check the code quality and all of those things. And also, as a customer, that's like a problematic thing, because if you set up a system, for example, you set up WooCommerce, you can't really do anything until you put 15 apps in there. You need an app for payment gateway, you need a theme, you need a loyalty point. So and you have so many apps that will finally make your WooCommerce work. So even as a consumer, it's not very friendly. So those are some of the reasons. And also the framework, Frappe framework, is what is these days called a low-code platform, framework. So it is easier to build new models in ERP Next. And these models, if somebody makes them, then, you know, it's really easy to start off and then build on them. So that's another reason why we can have a monolith, because the complexity does not scale as much. For every new model, there is not too much extra code. It is also multi-domain. So the first domain we started was a school system. The school to which my daughter goes, they wanted an ERP system. And they searched for a lot of free and open source ERP systems. So there is not there is no good school ERP system open source out there. And we realized that, and we thought, let's build something inside ERPNext, because you already have HR, you already have purchasing, you already have inventory, which schools need anyway. So that is how the domain concept started. And then we had a community contribution from in the form of the healthcare module. And one of the good things about that is that before the conference, there was this one gentleman who wanted to come from Somalia to the conference, and he realized that there is no Indian embassy in Somalia, so he can't get a visa again. But he said that there is a 100-bed hospital in Somalia that uses ERPNext healthcare module. So when you think about it, you know, these domains make it discoverable, and there is a lot of value when you set up multiple domains. And there are challenges also in this monolith, is that you need to have domain expertise on various topics like healthcare or manufacturing and, you know, schools. And this is a challenge. It becomes a bottleneck when everything has to go inside one system. Then, you know, merging things, how do you... So this model is not without its costs. There are definitely costs and there are benefits. So it's just at this point, we think this is a better model. And then there are other challenges like partitioning the product also, that so that you don't... So there are 600 doc types, but there should not be 600 tables. So this is a contribution that is already coming in, that unless you activate a module, the tables will not be created in the database. You know, so we are effectively working to partition the domains better. And the other thing is, you know, naming things, you know, which I think is one of the biggest aspects of designing products and multi-domains, is how you name things. And so these are some of the challenges that we face in this kind of architecture. I'm not saying it's perfect, but yeah, it's benefit, cost benefit. And then managing complexity. Like I said, you know, it's even though we have a low-code platform, it does increase the complexity, like of soil tracking or whatever. Another trend we have seen of late is growing contributions. This is a very healthy trend, which I was hoping for a very long time as a contributor. I mean, the normal thinking is if you are putting your code out there and there are other people who are coding, they should do the same. And that was my thinking, but I've evolved because I think that's a wrong way of thinking. I mean, there is no entitlement. Everybody is doing their own thing, and there is no real entitlement for anybody to contribute. So, but even then, people are realizing the value of contributing. So I just want to say, show the different phases. Like in the first phase, like bulk of contributions came from one team, that was the Frappe team, because that's how the project started. In the second phase, a lot of users started customizing their own ERPNext because it's open source. So the first thing you do is customization. And then you get into a customization cycle that runs into 2 weeks, a few months. And there are a lot of problems with customization. One is, once you open up the Pandora's box, there is no end to how much customization you can do. And then the second problem is that you delay the gratification. So as a company, you feel the problem today, but you go into a customization cycle that will take 3 months. And then after 3 months, you are frustrated because you still don't have a solution to your problem. And you know, your team gets frustrated and everybody's waiting for something. So it's always good to implement first and then customize. That's the second reason. And the third one is the quality of customizations, especially initially, is not really good. I mean, it takes a while to become a really good feature developer. And so that was the second phase, where a lot of, you know, I'm sure Dominic can talk more about that, but you know, the customization first. And then people understood the enlightened self-interest, as I will put it, that, you know, it's better to get it contributed to the core, because then you don't worry about upgrades. You get your code reviewed by the core team. You know, it's free consulting you get. You get free feedback. And so this thing is started now. And we're getting better here in this phase by basically... So currently the problem is the quality of contributions. Currently, I think there are more than 50 pull requests open on GitHub. And we need stricter processes. So there is there is automated testing and everything. So we have become very strict now in terms of, we'll not accept quality or those contributions that don't follow the contribution guidelines, and the tests don't pass. So that's how we're dealing with that. And we're having developer guidelines now, where this is much more documented that, you know, how would you design a form, how would you design your code, how will you indent your code, how will you structure your code. So all these things are now pretty well getting more and more documented. That is, yeah. So contributions is great. We are learning, we have the moderators, the maintainers are becoming the bottleneck, and it's a learning process. There was a time when we had 60 open pull requests, and we just decided, let's just close those who don't follow the contribution guidelines, and we were able to bring it down to maybe 20 to 25. So we are understanding the stricter we become, the bottleneck goes away, because then we give it back to the contributor to kind of come back with corrections. The other big, most interesting thing, those who have been following ERP Next for multiple years, is we saw two very large-scale deployments in ERP Next. So this is a consumer company. It is India's second largest retail stockbroker. And they are doing 9 billion invoices on ERP Next. So these are standard ERP Next invoices using the standard ERP Next GL entry. and they have scaled this in a vertical scaling manner. So it's just one table. So they put all these invoices, all their GL entries in one massive table, and they've done a massive cluster of MySQL instances that kind of scale it. So this was a huge confidence boost for us. And this company has been using ERP Next for 2 years, but we found out only like 2 months ago. So that is also and a win for open source, because companies are able to use ERP Next without really depending on, you know, Frappe support or something. So what we learned is, in vertical scaling, you will always hit a bottleneck, and you will have to either throw more computing power or, you know, come up with a new architectural structure to kind of break your vertical scaling. So this is, we are working with this team and understanding what are different strategies of vertical scaling on one side. And then you need large servers to kind of scale that kind of stuff. The other team, which is a logistics company, they are using horizontal scaling. So this model is really interesting, and this is something I personally find very interesting, is they are using a federated ERP Next. So this is a logistics company which has, they plan to have 2,000 warehouses in India. So what they're saying is each cluster of warehouse will run a separate ERP Next. And then you will roll up summary transactions to a consolidation instance. So instead of running one ERP Next for the entire company, you can run, you know, maybe tens of ERP Next, or, you know, maybe hundreds of ERP Next. And this has the potential of, you know, going to very, very, very large sizes, where you kind of delay scaling problems because you have broken up the architecture. And it's very interesting, because then you can assign a user to a particular node. So when they sign in, they just get redirected to their node, and then they see only their stuff. So in permissions, everything becomes much more contained. So this is really encouraging, like, to have tech-driven deployments. So both these deployments were driven by the tech team of the company and not the CFO. So this is, again, a big win for open source, that when Microsoft acquired GitHub, in the blog post, they said that every company is a tech company. And every decision, whether it is HR or CR or sales, will be made by somebody from the technology side. So this kind of validates what we saw in these two large deployments, that open source drove their decision to use ERP Next. And they are really happy, and they are very happy to be contributors, and both of them came to the conference and spoke about it. So that was a big shift, I think, in terms of the community. In terms of the ecosystem, the big problem still persists. How do you make money? Because if it's free, then, you know, what do you make money for? But we are learning that, you know, there is services. It's not a solved problem in a way, because if the software is really good, you don't need services. And if you want to earn from services, then you should make sure that there is some friction in the software. It's a reverse incentive, because if you want to make money, you have some friction, so somebody calls you and says, please create that for me. And that is what a lot of service providers also face. And the other thing is, what I recently read is the tragedy of commons, and I was also talking to Martin and Gunnar that Django, which is the popular Python framework, is also running out of contributors. So when you say that you put enough community, will it ensure contributions? Maybe not. There needs to be some structure around projects that will ensure that not only the financial incentives are ensured, but even the developers, and there is some process of knowledge sharing which happens in an ecosystem. Like I said, the conflict of the service provider versus the end user, we also had this in the conference where somebody just stood up and said, I don't like this community where the service provider is hated. you know, and then I had to say that, you know, the service provider exists for the end user. You know, you have to remember that it is the end user that is the most important and not the service provider. So we need to work this out, because if you see Udu, the reason why Udu does so well is because the partner ecosystem makes a lot of money. Because they stop upgrades, they have paid apps, and they have now 20, officially they have 20% stuff which is closed source. So ultimately, Udu is just a freemium. It's a trial version that you can use, and when you really want to use it, you have to pay. So that kind of becomes the benefit of the end user. How do we grow? How do we put more economics in the community? And it is also about culture. So if you have a culture where everybody who is on the forum is publishing their own private apps, they are doing their own private stuff, then somebody thinks like, why should I do it? You know, everybody, this is the way the community works, that, you know, everybody publishes their own thing. It's not really open source. And if I'm a new person, that's how I should behave. So it's important to have a culture where, and I've had to take a lot of bad blood in the community for this, that people don't like me for being kind of contribute, but it's about culture. You have to also, when you come to a community, you should know this is a sharing community where people are sharing. So it's also about, somebody has to be the bad person to drive the culture. I think that's, and some thoughts on Frappe, the company. A lot of people are still, even we are understanding like how is Frappe different from ERP Next, and that those kind of, that also evolved. So in the first phase of the company, we were doing everything. Like most of our time, we were investing in the product and the framework and the cloud and the community, doing discuss replies and other stuff. And it was not really, we were not really sure is the product ready, so we were just investing. You know, that was without really thinking about what will be the ultimate model. I mean, we obviously had the SaaS, and we thought that that should be enough. You know, we should stop thinking about anything else. So in the phase two, we started saying, okay, let's do the SaaS more seriously. Initially, we didn't even have a SaaS. We were just doing the product and doing sales, which really sucked. So we said, okay, let's do SaaS. Let's put the pricing that we don't care anybody not going to call us. We didn't have a phone number on the website for a long time. So, but then we have evolved. And in this phase, we are coming back to services. In a way, we always come back to things which we have abandoned. It's kind of a cycle for us. But this time we are more mature. I mean, we realize that visiting customers, understanding their point of view is actually valuable in building the product. Because till now we have only been building the product from our point of view. So it's the more we interact and the more services we do also adds value to the product. And it also, I mean, you can have a product, but you know, if nobody's going to implement it, then what's the use? So there is still gap in terms of people understanding to use the product. So that's, our goal in the long run is to do what Red Hat does, not do professional services as the core business. I mean, do it where there is nobody else providing it and that needs to happen, and let the ecosystem do the professional services. But we could do have standardized offerings for server support, functional support, mostly remote support, and bug fix guarantees and all of that. So currently we're doing consulting implementation and custom development, maybe, we're not sure. And lastly, I want to quickly touch upon is the foundation. So we also have ERP Next Foundation, which is a registered not-for-profit entity. We started this last year. And we really didn't know much about how to drive it, but it was just taken from, say, you have Linux Foundation and you have Mozilla Foundation. So we thought that's like the right model to have. If it's a community thing, it should be kind of supported by a not-for-profit entity. So that was the goal of the foundation. And a true open source product should be vendor neutral. So it should be something which any vendor can go and implement ERP Next. and not have a kind of disadvantage. If you take Udu, for example, if Udu does Udu, then they have a big advantage because they have a set of services which is private and closed. But we want to make sure that the foundation will ensure that the product remains a vendor-neutral product. There is no, doesn't tie into a specific vendor. And then we started with memberships. We really didn't know what to do with them, so we said, let's give people a listing on the website. And that's the only service that the foundation offers right now is a website listing. And and the goal is that this money that we have raised, which is around $45,000 right now with us, should be used to work on common goals. Could be a data export, which a lot of people want. So the foundation could be the place where somebody starts a group saying, okay, I'm starting data export, and then the foundation becomes a place where you could pool in the money, and then somebody decides. But the problem right now with the foundation is that it requires independent leadership, which personally I don't have the bandwidth at the moment, and neither it seemed anybody else in the community is ready to take up this role of becoming the community leader. So till there is a community leader, what we have proposed is, let's give away the money to proposals. So if community developers come up with a proposal that, I'm going to do this, and then the foundation can give up to $5,000 to that person to kind of build that feature. So at least we put that $45,000 to productive use. That is the target right now. And then do also events and code sprints, because like I said, having face-to-face conversations, having code sprints are another great way of sharing knowledge, where a group of developers sit together and build a product. We did that for the conference. We had a two-day code sprint, and I think there was a lot of knowledge sharing happening there. So maybe do more events and code sprints. Yeah, and like I said initially, the goal is to make it like a Linux Foundation or a Mozilla Foundation, where it runs as its own entity, and it supports the common part of the product, which everybody benefits from. So that's it, and yes, thank you.